Okay, we're back for another edition of Conversations with Alan Otte. We're going to start a new series, References and Connections in Percussion Literature. This may be a 4 or 5 part series where we're going to walk through basically the important historical touch points of the development of percussion. And I love your subtitle here, How and Why Percussionists Became Useful People in Western Art Music, A Path from Mahler's Cowbells and the Futurist Noise Intoners Through Varese's Sirens, and the Tin Cans and Amplified Cactus of John Cage to a Contributive Music for the 21st Century. Now, any book editor would tell you that subtitle's a little too long, but it gets to the point of what you're after here. So,
well, in case nobody's going to even look at the outline, much less read the book that doesn't exist, there it is. There's the encapsulation of my take on this whole thing. You know, I was talking to Tom Siwi years ago, who was one of the first, I think, to make a course, a little seminar for his upper level students to look at this kind of stuff. And I must have mentioned something about Mahler or coming out of the orchestra or something like that. And I just remember so well Tom saying, geez, there's so much to talk about. I can't get through, you know, if I start with Lou Harrison, I can't get through what I have time to do. I can't possibly start before it even happened. and yet for me, I think both my own history of having been such a student of orchestral percussion, loving that stuff and caring about it a great deal, wanting to keep that alive in my students with you know, the pedagogy of it. Mm-hmm. But also being here all of these years at a very big conservatory with wonderful orchestras and, you know, maybe doctoral students would come to the Black Earth Group or Percussion Group Cincinnati, knowing pretty well what they wanted to talk about. Any younger students, even master's students, were certainly still very interested in a wider range of things and knew better all things about orchestral percussion. And I just got the sense that in order for that I could make such a better advocacy for Cage and the music of my friends, if I could really articulate where it came from and why. And myself just became fascinated with this idea of the references and the connections, like what composers were having coffee with which poets and artists and who might have read what books or who attended which concerts or who, you know, who kind of had the same idea at the same time in different parts of the world and couldn't possibly have known that one and the other were thinking very similar things. When were pieces published? When did people first see the score of something? All of that is what, for me, the references and the connections came to be about. It was just sort of fun to trace all of that stuff. And as someone who happened to love the orchestral percussion writing of Mahler, what I knew of it, I wanted to know more. So that it became clear that that was a really historical touch point of how we sort of came out of the orchestra, or at least a place where the story could be told.
Yeah, I've always latched on to the concept of the journey of percussion from referential, so references and connections, but being referential to non-referential, you know, and yeah, have a way of telling the story in that way, you know, sort of built off of all of the concepts that I learned from you, all of these historical touch points. But that seems to be also a way to tell the story too, from percussion as other referencing some other thing to then becoming a sound element in and of itself.
Well, yeah, I mean, you make a good point about, for instance, opera. I think most of us by now have this sense that so much of what even got into the concert orchestra got there through the opera orchestra. And there it was easy. I mean, the composers who were, you know, I'm not even sure that they really needed to say something about the military. They probably just wanted to write for men's chorus, you know. So then it either had to be a monastery with monks, or it had to be a barracks, you know. So a lot of good snare drum music, you know, comes out of that. Sometimes it's on stage, sometimes it's in the pit, and as it all develops, you know, they're all the exotic thing. I mean, things come later with Puccini in the Asian references, but even Saint-Saëns in Samson and Delilah, you know, his references, exotic sort of things. You know, Rimsky-Korsakov, even before the 20th century, and the whole idea of frame drums, you know, playing frame drums in the southern regions of the Russian Empire. Of course, he would have known all about that and could write with some, he knew what he was doing when he wrote a good tambourine part in Scheherazade. So what then really caught my fancy in all of this was that we all know that Mahler was an opera conductor. and this is where I was able to make for myself at least a really great connection, which follows what you were saying, where something is starts as a reference, a very specific reference, but once it's in the mix, it's like this centrifuge, you know, it goes into the centrifuge, whether it's referring to something in nature or militaristic or nature, you know, thunderstorms or cymbals making wave sounds, very simplistic things, but effective, right? They are effects. Tambourines, you know, referencing some sort of specific folk music.
And thinking of like Mozart and Beethoven and Haydn with the Janissary instruments, referencing
as far back as,
referencing both militarism in a general sense, but also specifically some of the more exotic sort of Turkish military music where those instruments come from. Yeah.
So Mahler was employed even as a younger man. He was a conductor, opera conductor in a few other cities, and then ended up in Vienna, the heart of the whole thing. Here we are. He was there, I think, for 10 years, from 97 to 07, something like that. During that time, he did 89 performances of Wagner's Tannhäuser. There were only three operas that he performed more often than this particular one. I'm not exactly sure why this one was so popular in Vienna or with him in particular. So here you have, in 1845, and this is, as we say, Act One, Scene Three, the main character and a young shepherd and pilgrims. And Wagner here describes the scene, and we come to near the end there, where it says, "And from high on the left, one hears the ringing of cowbells." Herdenglocken sounds better. And in these stage directions, this is actually in the score. This is exactly what's printed in the score. at this point in the score, in the stage directions, it's even more specific. And what it means is that this was just an effect where the stagehands had been asked to you know, go down to the local farmer's supply and dig through the bins. And I must say, I even have an image of this. The first time that the Black Earth group was, I think we played in Germany and then we were going to Italy. So we went through the Alps. And I forget which little, you know, some little village, city there. We actually went to kind of a local farm supply because we wanted to buy Almglock. And they were arranged in big barrels, big wooden bins by size, because this was not about pitch, and right. They didn't care what the pitch was. Yeah. If you had a county fair winning prize steer, you know, there were the big bins of huge ones, and if you had a little, you know, little baby cow, there were the little ones. You know, we couldn't have been the only ones who were doing that, but it was a little unusual for a few American hippies started to show up with their pitch pipes going through every bin, you know, trying to pick out cowbells. It was also on that trip that we camped out. We never had enough money to spend too many nights in hotels, so we camped out. And there was one night, we all still tell the story, you know, it was dark, we didn't know where we were stopping, we just stopped somewhere, and in the morning, the mountainsides were just full of these beautiful sounds of the, whether they were goats or cows or what it was, but this gentle, you know, common, we all know what it sounds like now, but this sound of the random little jostling of all of these bells. So anyway, so what kind of struck me about this is that I think the stagehands would not have necessarily been taken aback by Wagner saying, okay, go to the farm supply, get a whole bunch of these things, and then one of you guys has to go up in the balcony up high on the left side and, you know, string them up, do something so that they can rattle and just make the ambiance as though we're in a, you know, alpine pasture.
Right.
Sounds like, looks like this, right?
Right.
So in this case, it's not even in, there's nothing in the musical score itself, because it's a stagehand. It's no different than if they had wind machines back then or whatever they were doing. It was some guy who just got the cue. When you hear the shepherd, make this sound. okay, so Mahler performs this piece 89 times in 10 years. He also has his own composition, little hot shed, you know, up in the mountains. Most summers, that's where he is. And though it occurs already in the Sixth Symphony, in 1905, in the Seventh Symphony, it's sort of more interesting how it happens there. So he has a similar in the second movement, which there are two Nachtmusik. So the first night music is the second movement. It's a sound Mahler would have known very well. And you see here in the list of instruments, of percussion instruments for the symphony, it just says Herdenglocken after, you know, the Kleintrommel, Rute, and then Herdenglocken. And maybe we'll come back to this this picture in a moment for the deep ringing bells. So it's a sound he knew, but what's sort of interesting about this is that it's not like he had to go to the principal percussionist or the timpanist of the Vienna State Opera and tell that, you know, pretty special musician, could you go out into the countryside, find a farm supply, look for, I think they would have said, I'm not sure, they would have taken very well to that. They were already there. He had used them, you know, by this time he had used them 50 times. They were just somewhere laying backstage at the opera. And, you know, who knows? I don't know if in all of the Mahler scholarship, in the huge volumes of biographies, I don't know, there, you would think somewhere there's a funny story of him thinking of it, you know, of how to use this. But I think it's significant that again, even now, sometimes we feel we would be reminded of Cage saying that what he loved about percussion, what he wished is that the rest of the orchestra would become as open and poverty-stricken as the percussionists are. Not that the percussionists should be elevated to the status of first chair players, but so we're used to being the ones who have to drop the needle on the record of the bird song in the Pines of Rome. Here's a case where it wasn't that big a step to get this to happen. So we could listen to this one. It's very similar to what happens in the turns out that this is not such an easy thing to do, actually, to make that sound. In the score, he says that it should be, forgetting the words exactly, but it's very clear. He says, you know, randomly done, the sound of these cowbells. and again, it has to be unintentional. And we've all seen this, we've heard it, you know, if you set up a rack of different cowbells and actually go and play them, you can play them randomly, but it's not going to be unintentional. It's going to sound, there's no way for that not to sound like moderno music playing some lick on cowbells. Once in a while, what you can see, if you take, you know, a very small hanging strand of camel bell, something not so big, and you could shake that almost like sleigh bells, sort of. And the trouble with that is that then they're smaller, you know, they're all much smaller bells, and they don't have the sense of these bigger, deep, you know, real pasture bells. So every time we've done it with the school orchestra here, I, in searching for how to make this unintentional, you know, like Cage again talks about music of contingency, music which is contingent upon the fact that you can't become an amplified cactus virtuoso. You have to be careful, and it's not going to do what you want. It will do what it wants. Or similarly, the gurgling of a conch shell. So how to make the? I mean, I was sort of in the mode of, you know, how to make this unintentional. These are sitting on the floor in this photograph. This bar would then be, of course, placed on two stands, standards, so that the cowbells are whatever, shoulder height or eye height or something like that. And what actually happens in this way, and you see that I have big ones and little ones all mixed in different spots, and I'm not at all careful about how they're attached to that rack, because the idea is what we did is to just jostle them, you know, you, by hand, get up there and push them, and they knock into one another. Okay, so that's not what's happening in the pasture. The cows are not bumping into one another. Somehow, I was quite satisfied that this gave the right effect because I couldn't control it exactly. Sometimes you push it and they wouldn't get a good contact. Sometimes they'd hit a little too hard. You could move around. A big one would hit a little one, a few other ones. And just, you know, to push back and forth absolutely gave and you know, this sort of uncontrollable, random little ambience.
Sort of like wind chimes, kind of a wind chime effect.
Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah. A very good and simple way to, and maybe it was even in the back of my mind. Huh, Gary can just have wind chimes.
You know? Yeah, get Gary on that. He should make Mahler chimes.
Another wonderful thing about Gary and the Woodstock chimes is that he told me early on is that he spent a lot of time, they're not only beautifully tuned, you know, in all kinds of just intonation kind of ways, but he said he specifically designed the distance and the weight of that knocker thing to be inefficient. So that the damn things weren't ringing all the time and annoying you, yeah. that it's specifically engineered for inefficiency.
Interesting.
Okay, so there are the cowbells.
There's the cowbells. Should we go to the...
The last movement. So now we come to the fifth movement, the end of the symphony. Now, if we could go back to this list of instruments... Yeah, that was...
Sorry, I went too far. There we go.
There it is. So, the very last one, deep bell ringing. In the second, the third, the ninth symphony, he specifically says, you know, deep bells, he gives specific pitches. Here, he writes this, and the translation, a translation, would be various untuned steel slabs of a timbre similar to bells struck irregularly. That's completely different than the second, the third, the ninth symphony, where, you know, I guess clearly there's some sort of, or one would say there's a reference maybe to church bells, to some heroic kind of beauty in that sense. This sentence could not possibly be clearer that that's not what he's talking about here. I don't know. Again, maybe it could be found somewhere in the depths of all of his correspondence or biographies or something. But I had the sense that what this meant was, you know, we have an early movement, which is rural. We have rural, gentle metallic sounds. And then we have a final movement where we're clearly in downtown Vienna. It's an urban, random, metallic sound. This is absolutely the era, the beginning of the era of steel girders and building skyscrapers and the, you know, the noise of of the modern industrialized city. I don't know, but I think because of this sentence that he writes, and because it's different than his other symphonies, a nice argument can be made for what this might be. Once in a while, you see that people don't use. Often, people would just use chimes or something like that.
Yeah.
Sometimes now you see people with bell plates, you know, big Stockhausen-like square bell plates. A trouble with those might be also that I've seen them played with sort of nice, softer beaters, and then they're a little too gong-like. So we had another solution to that. Do we want to listen to a little bit of this?
We could listen and then show you the photograph.
Sure. Okay.
Thank you.
that's an old LP that I had of the Concertgebouw with Bernard Haitink playing. It's, you know, I'm embarrassed to say how many recordings of Mahler Seventh I have, CDs and LPs, and going through all of these things, you know, brilliant orchestras, great percussionists, brilliant conductors, and it's really hard to find examples that I think do justice to this beautiful moment. In one sense, you would, in many cases, I think the conductor didn't care about it that much. It was not the most important thing, and whatever happened, they didn't talk about it. They just did something. Because when in that last movement, when he wanted these untuned steel slabs, the Herdenglocken also play. So the gentle little rustling of the mountains in the second movement comes back combined with these steel slabs. Well, it doesn't mean anything. I think it's already a good example of, I can imagine him being at the first rehearsal and the cowbells were done. You know, they did what they were supposed to do, but they're still sitting there and the guy who played them is just sitting there doing nothing. And Mahler stops the rehearsal and says, you know, we could use more sound here. Could you just hit those things too? And so the guy had to play the cowbells as well. And that's how they got in there. What's been actually great in the last decade or so is the scene shop at CCM. Or maybe it's more than a decade already. You know, everything used to be built out of 2x4s, all the opera and musical theater and all of that stuff. And whenever a show was over, then there'd be cartloads of the debris of breaking down these things out back of the conservatory. It was always 2x4s. In more recent years, they don't use wood. It's all welded together out of these various, I'm not sure what they call them, these pipe kind of things. So I always hang around outside after shows and see what they're throwing out, you know, and check the pitches and drag some back in. So that's what these are. In fact, the biggest one you see is even curved. That was some piece of scenery, the skeleton of some piece of scenery of some play or musical or something. And the impurity of having that that little bend in it was actually pretty enhancing to the whole thing. So you see that they're not perfectly set up at nodal points where they ring quite nicely, but I'm not looking for good chime sounds. I'm looking for workers building a skyscraper out of steel girders. Yeah. And we ended up with these lead plumber's pipes. We started with chime mallets, but by the end of the piece, the whole orchestra is playing with great fervor. And turned out that the contact sound of these of metal on metal was you know, thrillingly the right noise to be added at that point. So there you have it. Those are the untuned steel slabs of a timbre similar to Bell's. And now that I'm retired, I'm sure that Cully threw them out. my friend, the composer Bill Fotis, years ago, sent me this thing from, I think it's from 1901 even or something. The front piece of a little music magazine, a humor magazine, Humorous Weekly. So you see the cowbells, the sleigh bells from the Fourth Symphony, the Ruta is hanging there. It's interesting, the hammer sitting on a timpani, again, it's a cartoonist drawing this thing. Right. He was referencing the Hammerschlag, right, which Right. It's not an interest. It's not even an instrument. It's an idea. You know, yeah. Good luck on what you're going to make of this idea.
Yeah. You know, so, it's sort of surprising. I don't mean to cut in, but it always surprised me that, that you didn't focus more on the hammer as this strangely, you know, psychological. Here's percussion as psychology. You know, we've got references to, we talked earlier, you know, militarism, and then now we've got agrarian, rural versus the cityscape. So those are all still references, but the hammer of fate, you know, this is a psychological thing. And who better, you know, what better thing to deliver that than an actual hammer that has the psychological, you know, connection with the visual of hitting the hammer and all of that. That seems like a pretty momentous moment for percussion as well.
Yeah, I'm glad that you bring that up. That should definitely be in the discussion. This particular one. And you know, Berg, then in the three orchestra pieces by Berg, from just a few years, you know, within a decade after this, he used that again. The hammerschlag, you know, in that sense, it had already become a sound. It was no longer a stroke of fate. It was just a sound. In the percussion section. So Webern, also made some living by conducting. I don't remember which Mahler symphony it was, but he was hired to rehearse and conduct the premiere of one of the Mahler symphonies. And he had used up, like, whatever the story is, you know, up until the last hours of the dress rehearsal, and he hadn't gotten beyond the first couple of pages of the whole symphony. So they fired him and hired somebody who could just get through it. You know, just like, the connection between the Mahler Seventh Symphony, these two sounds in it, and then just 5 years later, a piece by Webern, in the third movement of the Opus 10, five pieces for orchestra, there's one gentle, quiet little movement where you have the deep bells and the Herdenglocken. Can you find those with your cursor?
Well, let's see. Mm-hmm. I'm having a hard time seeing it.
Yes, you're getting it. There it is. Those are the Herdenglocken. Uh-huh. Yep. And that's, and then above that, the line above that is the, here he says one deep bell. Yeah. But for the purposes of our argument, I'm claiming this is a literal quote. He's just taking these two sounds out of the Mahler symphony. And like you had mentioned earlier, you know, we put something into this centrifuge and it's used for a specific referential purpose. But once it's there, I mean, how many snare drum parts are there in the early literature of the orchestra where at some point it's making its little militaristic rhythmic beats, but at many other points, it's making beautiful rolls, it's making, you know, it's supporting some other rhythms. It has nothing to do with the military.
Right.
But it got there because it was referencing something else. All of our instruments have that history to them. And here's a historical moment where I think we could have fun to make the case that Webern, who knew the Seventh Symphony very well and knew exactly what the instrumentation was, he had seen these instruments. Here they are used as a sound, referencing nothing. The way they're written, you can also see that there's a bass drum part, there's a snare drum part, and it's all used in the same way. It's just a single, you know, tremoloed note. It's like electronic music decades before one could write electronic music. We could listen to a little bit of this. Again, it's very, very quiet. It's very much in the background. What you'll hear more clearly is the harp and the celeste who have a little oscillating ostinato kind of feeling. But A couple of, I think, not stupid points is that you could make the one could make the same argument for the rest of that Webern piece, listening to those little violin fragments or the clarinets or trombones. You know, in one sense we could say, well, it's, you know, sounding very, very modern and pre-12-tone music. One could also think of it as being, if Webern took any later Mahler orchestra score and stripped out just, you know, that little piece of percussion ambiance, you could do the same thing and go to any given two measures of a violin part and just snip out that little violin line, take away all of the other changing, cascading harmonies that are surrounding it. And in every case, I think you could almost say that his first step towards the music he arrived at was sort of an erasure of where Wagner and Mahler had brought these things to. Angularly moderno as those little lines might have sounded, if they had a couple of chords surrounding them, they would make perfect sense in any Mahler piece or Wagner piece. Yeah. That particular movement ends with a solo snare drum roll, as quietly as possible, just a snare drum roll. Yeah. It's also interesting to note in that score, we don't have to look at it again, but even when the bells stop, the Almglocken and the deep bells, even says to dampen them, that you don't just do it and kind of let them ring. He was really thinking like what became splicing in electronic music, that sound, and then he very carefully says, stop the sound, you know, and then the bass drum sound comes, and then the bells start again, and then, yeah, I'm excited about it, but it's in the whole history of the development of Western music, okay, pretty small point, a few seconds of cowbell music. And yet for us, for those of us who then have ended up, you know, knowing Almglocken because of Stockhausen's Zicklus and who make all kinds of pieces out of found objects. It's not unconnected to the history of very thoughtful composers who throughout our times, their times into our times, were looking for the sounds that could somehow convey something. And I love this idea that they got there for a reason, but once they were there, everybody was happy they were there. And well, let's keep using them.
Yeah. So. No, I mean, clearly it's a, you know, a subject that this particular reference that really interests you in, but it's a really good one. I mean, it's a good point that you can very clearly see how it moves from the entering the orchestra in this way as Mahler did, and then how it becomes, well, as Wagner introduces the idea, then becomes Mahler's, and then becomes Webern's. I mean, it's a very clear and concise example. Whereas if you trace the development of something like the triangle or something, it's a little bit more circuitous and spans many, many decades. And, you know, this is a very clean, you know, way of seeing that through
in a
line.
Very short time span.
In a short time span, yeah. Well, relatively, but yeah. I mean, within 100 years, right? I mean, less than 100 years.
The Webern and the Mahler were
well, I see. We're pretty close together.
Yeah, yes. And you're right. That Wagner was, you know, well, I also read... Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, well, I was going to ask you because I remember from my doctoral days this question coming up about the centrifuge and having to think this through, and that's why I referenced it. I think the triangle is a good example, and so I have a whole way of talking about that. But the other part of the question that you posed to me in that was, okay, very good. So you've been able to trace the through line with this thing. Now tell me something that's resisted. What instrument has entered the sound world of the orchestra that's resisted becoming, you know, a coloristic sound source, not referencing where it came from? Can you think of an instrument that, in that regard, and that's a much harder question. I think I said maybe the drum set, that it always felt like it was referential of jazz or popular music as it's come into various.
Yeah.
So that I think that was my answer, but then I think your answer was the steel drums you had not been able to incorporate in some way, that when you hear that sound, it always sounds like Caribbean music. Okay, well, this is a good place to stop for this first foray into this development of percussion, and we'll pick it up here next time.
Okay. Nice to see you. Thanks.
Good.